Hey everybody, stay tuned today when I'm talking to Brian and Jeff about the technical considerations that you need to think about within your cloud adoption strategy. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we're having technical conversations with Microsoft experts about some of the questions or concerns that you might have with your cloud adoption journey. Now, in previous episodes, we talked about how the cloud adoption framework can really help you accelerate that cloud adoption journey. Today's episode is focusing on the strategy piece and the technical considerations that you need to think about when executing your strategy. Now, I have two guests with me today. I have Brian and I have Jeff with me. However, my first question is for Brian, and thank you for being on the show again with me, Brian. What I want to ask you is about the technical considerations that organizations have to think about when they're embarking on their strategy journey.
Yeah, so when we think about the cloud adoption strategy as a whole, there's a lot of different things that you might want to accomplish. And all of those different objectives that you have come with different learning curves. Most of those learning curves by themselves are small, but when you're trying to accomplish a large digital transformation, those learning curves add up and they take time. They also require proper timing for stakeholder alignment, to analyze data, really validate the decisions you're making, and get the people, the processes, and the technology aligned to really drive that transformation. So even when you're doing really well with your adoption efforts, planning takes a little bit of time. And it runs in parallel to what you're doing. So it's important to notice that there's a big difference between your cloud adoption plan and your cloud adoption strategy. So if you have that well-defined strategy, it's going to help really figure out how to guide implementation and really guide the things you need to learn as you go. And that all starts with a good understanding of technical considerations.
Are there any benefits of running your first adoption process in parallel with the development of your plan at all?
Definitely. So there's quite a few benefits, actually. So when we approach cloud adoption with a growth mindset, one of the biggest things we think about is learning and exploration. And with each of those, what we're trying to do is create situations where the team can go and do things that will contribute to your end goal, but knowing that they're going to have to build skills. And by taking a first adoption project approach, we set them up to really get those skills, to collaborate, to identify gaps in their plan, and really build the right degrees of partnerships that they need to really validate the plan and be successful longer term.
That sounds great. In terms of practical examples, have you got any that are great for first projects and the expectations to have of those first projects you select, Brian?
Yeah, and this is where the strategy and the plan start to commingle a little bit. You have to understand what your motivations are to pick the right first project. So an example of that is, let's say that your overall plan is long-term, you want to get into really deep digital innovation and big data. Well, you probably don't need to focus as much on infrastructure for your first project. It's probably more about, how do I move my data? But if your real objective is you want to get out of a data center and modernize IT operations, well, then you have to start with a different set of first projects. Maybe it's building a network and migrating a workload or two so that you can really see what migration looks like. Or if you're just trying to add reliability and dependency into overall IT operations, then maybe your first project is something simpler, like using Azure Site Recovery to recover some systems that you have on-prem into the cloud. So it really depends on what you want to get out of it. And knowing your objectives helps you really define that strategy, align to the motivations that you have, and choose a project that's going to help you move forward in the right direction and learn the skills that you really need.
That's great. Thank you, Brian. It's definitely making me think about that different motivations have different first projects, which kind of leads me into a question that I want to ask Jeff, if that's okay, if we can bring Jeff on. Jeff, welcome to the show, firstly. So thank you for your time. And also, the question is, can you help me understand the differences between the on-premises motivations versus the cloud motivations that we have?
Oh, absolutely. Great question. And first, just a quick hi. My name is Jeff Amels. I'm a senior business planner out of Microsoft Corporate, but I tend to classify myself as a data center architect that likes to do his own taxes. Now, your question, the basic differences between like on-premise and how we think about cloud adoption, it's a fundamental shift on how we look at the workload modernization. So there's some very basic differences between on-premise and how you think about the cloud, both from a technical and financial standpoint. Like historically, on-premise servers, when we thought about like refreshing our workloads and building out that infrastructure to support what the business units are requesting, we typically focused on buying servers for the worst case scenario within a term, like a financial term or a business cycle, if you will. So we're buying gear for that those peak utilization periods. Now, the downside to that is your systems, the bulk of the time, are underutilized. These business cycles of utilization fluctuate depending on like industry verticals. Like for example, in the retail industry vertical, you have 4 to 6 spikes per year of utilization where your data center resources are at their max capacity, while the rest of the time, they're completely underutilized, sometimes at 30% or 20 to 30% of utilization, even with the core allocations. Now, the cloud shifts models towards dynamic allocation of capacity versus that static allocation of capacity. So when you think about that, you start architecting your solutions a little bit differently. And that really comes into like 3 different categories. 1, infrastructure as a service. 2, platform as a service. And 3, software as a service. Now, starting with that infrastructure as a service component, that's where we're really catering to the compute that we're used to, that unit level compute of resource allocation at the core and memory footprint level, as well as how that maps to virtual machines and how they leverage those resources, as well as storage. And when we think about that platform as a service level, you're getting more value out of every dollar of investment because you're no longer concerned about the underlying compute, managing the operating system and those type of resources and physical transports, for example. So you're not dealing with those underlying components, but you're really focused at the particular workload. So you're paying for specific services like database platforms or analytics platforms that are delivered directly without that overall operational overhead or underlying resources that you have to manage. And then you start thinking about the software as a service layers where you're getting the most value out of every dollar of investment, but it's a more managed experience. It's an encapsulated experience around common services like email systems, file sharing, Teams, and communications types of services. And as you work through those layers, you are getting more value out of every dollar of investment over time. And a lot of times I classify it as modernizing your workloads through phases. And it's a great way to classify that.
Awesome. Thank you, Jeff. In terms of trying to translate the workloads that our customers have in their existing environment and moving into the cloud, how does that work? How can they do that?
Oh, excellent question. A great concept to keep in mind is how you provision or spin up resources, as well as equally important, how you deprovision resources and how that influences your overall budgetary allocation and how you're using your budgets. That cash flow to support those particular workloads. The nice thing about the cloud is that you're able to deploy resources very, very rapidly. As well, and equally important, keeping in mind that you can deprovision those resources very, very rapidly. So your cash flow to support those workloads, to support them in those particular scenarios can fluctuate depending on demand. I call this concept as like a fail fast type of model. So like, for example, a business unit has a request to IT to provision a resource. It doesn't work out. So maybe they deprovision those resources, hence concurrently the cash flow as well that you could provision to a new type of deployment. It's very, very dynamic versus the historic like static resource allocation that we're used to historically in IT. So you're not stuck with that budgetary allocation for a longer period of time. You could shift as it's required, both based off of success and failure of the deployment or based off of overall demand and utilization. Now, another thing to keep in mind and something that we're seeing more and more of is more modular components making up an overall application that you're delivering to a business unit. Like, for example, you can have encapsulated business logic within an Azure formula or function versus having multiple roles on one single compute unit or VM. Because historically, we're used to deploying a VM. It's running like SQL and some business logic and maybe a web front end all in one instance. But we're seeing more of a breakout of those components so they could be modularized and some pieces being at the IaaS level and some components being at those platform as a service level. So when we're thinking about architecting a solution that's hosted in the cloud, certainly start thinking about those modular pieces because they also map to native cloud billing models and those offering constructs that are available from cloud providers. For example, you might have a pre-existing investment in your licensing infrastructure on-premise, those Windows licensing and SQL licensing. And you want to be able to leverage those to the fullest extent. And you can use like the Azure hybrid benefit that gives you that license portability to not just use that license on-premise, but also in the cloud, both at the IaaS level and even in through my managed SQL instances at the PaaS level. So certainly something to consider at the long term. And then also for those compute instances that are long running instances, start thinking about longer term commits like reserved instance pricing and whatnot that really kind of play into a lower price point per compute hour for those production level systems. And then those short, those systems that may have high resource allocation, like a high number of cores in memory, but you only need them for a short amount of time. There's also offering constructs like spot level pricing that has a much, much lower price point per compute hour, but really are leveraged in a short amount of time for those like quick batch level processes that are high resource utilization, but you want to pay a low price point for.
Now, earlier you talked about the cloud shifts the model away from the, you know, the static allocation to a dynamic allocation of resources. And that's a big driver for our customers kind of choosing the cloud. How does that change the mindset and being able to operate with that elasticity that they now have in the cloud?
Oh, great question. As you're looking at moving those workloads to cloud, you might start classifying some of like the different behaviors of those particular workloads or compute units. Like, for example, you may have production systems that are those long running instances that need to be up 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. So when we're building out like models and projecting out cost and architectural changes, we may classify those particular production long running instances in a reserved instance scenario where we're doing long-term commits, we're getting like a lower price point. And that could be a subset of your overall footprint. Now, there are going to be other particular nodes that are serving up an application to the business unit that might have spikiness in utilization throughout a term. And we'll start looking at those and classifying them as and looking at their behavioral uptimes and classifying those as pay-as-you-go scenarios, because you don't need those up 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. They may have different percentage uptimes within a monthly period or within a financial term. So you're not paying for the actual downtime of those units. And then as we do data center analysis and map those to cloud targets, we always see additional nodes that are no longer required. So we can actually deprecate those nodes. You don't need to move those to the cloud. They're not utilized. And that's immediate savings. Or within that same exercise, we'll look at the actual utilization of the core assignments and memory footprint and right size those depending on the overall utilization that's discovered. So that I classify the thinking and approach to this as kind of a peeling the onion exercise. Let's start with those long running computes. Let's put them in the best cost classification as possible as you're moving them to the workload and then looking or to the cloud, and then start looking at the other workloads and the behaviors of them with respect to percentage uptimes and placement and applying the right cost structures for those.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jeff, for your time. Actually, thank you both for your time today. I really do appreciate the time that you've taken to talk me through technical considerations for that cloud adoption strategy. Now, thank you to all our viewers, and please do check out the description for more resources about what the boys have both talked about. And we'll look forward to seeing you in future episodes of the Azure Enablement Show.